Hi guys, it's MJ, the student actuary, and I'm back here with Tiff, who studied actuarial science at Tux University. And in this discussion, we're going to talk about what Tiff does day to day in the whole realm of actuarial science. So Tiff, please can you, welcome back, and please tell us more about your day to day job as an actuary.
So I think it's, I should actually go back in the past a little bit and tell you a bit more about my other jobs before I go to my current role. I worked at a bank for a while as a business analyst, and this was not in an actuarial capacity. So it was a year and a half, and I highlight this because if you have an actuarial science degree and you choose not to go into the industry, you can always become a business analyst or do another sort of job, any sort of
financial
whatever you want to do. So I did that for a year and a half, and I was still writing exams. And then I decided to go and work at a life insurance startup. And that was quite an interesting place to work. It was the only two actuaries were myself and the head of actuarial. And so I got a very wide, broad view on all the responsibilities and everything that one has to or can do in a life insurer. So there was product development. So that's going down from what sort of benefits should we offer? What does the policy wording look like? It involves so many different teams, the legal team, the ops. Can we do that? The legal team saying, well, is that legal to put this in your policy? Is it all those things? And
what would be an example of something that's illegal to put in your policy? Like, what are you not allowed to put in?
So there's a whole lot of requirements of stuff you should put in, like that you have to put in. Mm-hmm. So you can't go against anything that is in the Long-Term Insurers Act.
So can I put this in my product? Can I say that you buy life insurance, mm-hmm. and then upon the death of your loved one, a coin is flipped. And if it's heads, your benefit is doubled. If it's tails, your benefit is lost. Would that be something that we're not allowed to put in the product?
So you wouldn't be allowed to put that in your product, because the fundamentals are it cannot be a gamble. It's not a gamble. Mm-hmm. So if it's in any way represents a gamble, then it's just...
You need the gambling license.
Yeah. I'm not sure exactly, but and also has to be... You have to leave the person in the same financial position, or whoever the beneficiary is, as they were before the event happened. So adding that dimension to it won't really fly. So.
Okay, fair enough.
Another interesting thing was model development.
Mm-hmm.
There's pricing models, there's valuation models, there's a lot of requirements that... you need to submit sort of quarterly valuations, and I'm not entirely sure. I was only there for 4 months, so I wasn't there for the whole 12 months.
Did you get fired?
I was not fired. No. I actually got the opportunity to move to Cape Town, so I...
Was this back in Joburg? What was this life insurance startup doing differently? Like, why were they starting out? Like, what was their business philosophy?
So their business philosophy was to use alternative methods of distribution. So they wanted to partner with sort of Mr. Price and sort of retailers and give life insurance through sort of the cards of Mr. Price, for example. And to try, they didn't want to compete with the old mutuals and the Sanlams of the world.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to be the sort of niche market. They also had a free, what would happen is if you bought another product, they'd give you 6 months free life insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, it would start kicking in your premiums.
That sounds, the company's not my way by any chance, is it?
No, it's not.
Let's
not name names.
So I was thinking, my way does something similar like that, where they give you free life insurance, mm-hmm. for like a month. But you're like, well, whatever, it's quite weird selling insurance through those those channels? I mean, look, the way I see insurance is that it's a big financial decision. It's a responsible decision that people make, and they want to buy it with someone holding their hand per se. You know, they want to go to the broker. They want to sit in the fancy office. They want to spend a day going through the different options, reading the fine print before signing it.
Yes.
I kind of feel like, especially you see a lot of these times you get these SMSs like, "Oh, buy insurance, you know, over the phone or buy it online." I don't know, maybe it's a cultural thing, but I feel insurance is too, it's too, what could you say, too formal to be, you know, just sold at, say, a Mr. Price or something like that.
Yes, yeah, no, I completely agree. And I feel like a lot of the target market that they were trying to reach was too financially unsophisticated to be able to completely understand how the product works. Mm-hmm. So if you give them a 10-page policy document with legal terminology, chances are they're not going to understand exactly how the product works. So another thing would be that it's not. I think a lot of people would be unaware that they actually even have the product.
Yes.
If you sell it to them in this way. Or they forget that they have the 6 months and they've already given their bank details. Mm-hmm. They've already committed. They've already not signed a contract, but they've agreed over the phone. So there's all these not ethical. It's sort of how do you sell such a sophisticated product via this distribution channel to this specific target market?
Mm-hmm.
So it has its own challenges. I mean,
well, already if you look at, say, the office premium, or, you know, you've got the premium that contains all the admin expenses and the brokerage fees and stuff, that makes up quite a big proportion of, you know, the final premium. You know, you've got the risk premium, which is just the actuarial risk and paying the benefit, and then all these admin expenses. And they're quite high, you know, actuarial salaries, offices, brokerage commission, all this type of stuff. Now, when people try and sell insurance on, I think they call it micro insurance, or, you know, insurance on a much smaller level, yes, you're reducing the risk premium, but that office premium very much stays the same. Yes, there's a lot you can try and get rid of, you know, using the internet instead of a broker and, you know, clever stuff like that. But it still becomes quite an expensive product. And like you said, it's quite a sophisticated product for someone who's, you know, just getting to the grips with, you know, basic accounting and managing their income and the expenses on a month-to-month basis. These products are designed to, you know, look into the future and, you know, forecast different risks that can happen. And I mean, and a lot of people don't want to think about all the terrible things that can happen, because I think there's even some behavioral finance thing about that. Like, if you think about a problem, you then estimate the chance of that to be higher or something like that. It's some weird psychological thing. So, but let's return back to you. So after you got fired from this,
moved to Cape Town, got fired. But...
So after you put the gambling element in your product, and the lawyers were like, "This is illegal," you've moved to Cape Town.
Yes.
And what did you do? What made you want to come to Cape Town?
So at the time, sort of had family moving down, so I moved down with family, and I decided, what the heck, Joburg, I'm young enough and I'm crazy enough to pick up and move to another city.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually quite amusing, because my last day in the office at the life insurer,
mm-hmm.
I didn't have a job in Cape Town. I was leaving the next day to Cape Town. And that afternoon, I got the offer from my current employer.
Oh.
Yes. So that was a good stroke of luck. So it was moving from a life insurance space to a medical space, or health insurance space, or can't really say health insurance in South Africa because there's a difference between health insurance and medical schemes. But mm-hmm. anyway, a medical scheme administrator in Cape Town. And I moved into a traditional actuarial role, which in the medical scheme industry. It focuses around benefit design, pricing of benefits, contribution changes, a whole lot of that kind of stuff. So, for example, you'll have a scheme coming to you and asking you, so we have a lot of people requesting or a lot of people wanting to go for a certain operation, like cataract surgery, for example. And then they'd ask you, so how much is it going to cost them and how much is it going to affect their contributions? And then you'd have to go and price it based on the data that you have. And if you don't have data, you have to look at alternative sources. And then basically you price that in, and then sort of it gets carried through into the contributions that the members pay.
Where do you get your data from? I mean, I'm sure you must have a little bit of data on hand that you guys have used before. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have specific data, like, is there like an online eBay where you go and buy data, or how does that work?
So we are an administrator. That means we are not a medical scheme.
Mm-hmm.
We're a medical scheme administrator. And basically that means that we administer quite a few schemes, and we also provide actuarial services to quite a few schemes. And this has been going on for quite a number of years. So we do have data, and it's quite a rich data environment, because mm-hmm. if you think about life insurance, you claim once and then your policy lapses, or your lapses is a bad word, your policy is finished.
Yes, it ends.
With health, or with medical scheme environment, you can have multiple claims over the year. It's all short term as opposed to long term as well. You have multiple claims from multiple benefit categories. You know, some claims can be prescribed minimum benefits, others can be just benefits that the scheme itself offers on top of the PMBs. There's a whole lot of complexities there.
Mm-hmm.
And the data has all of those aspects within it. So you'll have all the column names for a variety of different things, as opposed to life insurance, where you have the risk factors and you'll have the premium and you have the expected mortality. That's it. Mm-hmm. Whereas, the medical scheme environment is much more data rich.
And this is what you've done your fellowship in, been in health.
Yes.
And was it difficult studying for that fellowship, knowing that you worked in that environment, or did you have to like read a bunch of notes and be like, oh, I didn't know that, I can apply that to my work? How was that procedure?
So it was actually quite cool, because I moved to a new team a couple of months ago before I wrote fellowship. It's a group of actuaries within the company I work for, and we don't do traditional actuarial work. We do more the statistical analysis. What I'm trying to say is I got a view on both sides of healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
So you get the traditional actuarial that's very like backbone, like how do we set contribution rates so that we can cover all the future claims sort of thing. And then you've got the more technical, how do we model or modeling of doctor profiling, and more in-depth things like pilots for certain systems going to doctors and that sort of stuff. So it's more technical, it's more programming.
Well, just talking about this whole medical stuff, I mean, the one thing that we're seeing on the news all the time now is Obamacare, you know, especially something that Trump has shown that he doesn't like it that much. I'm not in the health space, and I don't really know Obamacare too well. And I'm just having a shot in the dark. Have you looked at Obamacare? Do you know what it's about? And if you have, what is your opinion?
So I actually haven't. What I can say about Obamacare is that they, from what I have read, they're also struggling with very big increases
mm-hmm.
To their premiums. And that's super relevant in the South African environment as well. But apart from that, no, I haven't really looked into it. There's a lot of politics within healthcare that are happening in South Africa without having to jump over the sea.
Because, I mean, that's the one thing about medical schemes is they're not for profit,
yes.
if I understand correctly, which is weird because, I mean, your business, I take it is a business and not a charity. You know, you don't work for free. You know, so there are these administrative costs, and there are ways to profitize it. But this whole philosophy of it, you know, not being for profit, and the fact that you, maybe you can correct me here, like you can't turn anybody away, no matter their risk factor and stuff like that. Do you think that that is sustainable, or do you think that is fundamental to the whole thing of a medical scheme?
So when the Medical Schemes Act came out a couple of years ago, the idea was they want to move into an environment where more people have access to healthcare, and by having these, you know, open enrollment, which is basically you cannot turn anyone away, you, and also community rating, is only, you can only charge a certain premium. You can charge a premium based on the option that you choose, whether you're an adult or a child, or your family size, or your income level, sorry. And so it's all about promoting universal access to healthcare, because if you now are able to risk rate, you start excluding people that are too old or too sick.
The people who need it most.
The people who need it the most.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's also based on this, the concept that you contribute what you can afford, but you use what you need.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think the problem now is that you have many different schemes. Some of them are open. That means that anyone can join them. Closed schemes mean it's sort of an employer group where only people who are employed by the employer group can join. open schemes, there's a couple of open schemes now in the industry that have become quite competitive. And because of this community rating, you need healthy lives in your risk pool to cross-subsidize the older, sicker lives.
Mm-hmm.
And so this has caused, in the medical scheme industry, certain schemes to start cherry-picking healthy lives. Mm-hmm. And then you get all sorts of things like vitality to try and attract the healthier, younger people. You get benefit design, which favors people who like sort of offers benefits like, I can't even think of anything, like physiotherapy, for like, so that will attract people who are more active and into sports and all of that. And so then you're stuck with, what happens is you get the schemes, some schemes are now losing members that are more healthy to the bigger ones that are cherry picking, that are offering these benefits. And then the schemes that are losing the healthy members, their risk pool starts to deteriorate. So you're getting contribution increases year on year that are surpassing inflation. And this just keeps going on because the healthier members in those schemes are now realizing, okay, wait, this is not affordable. I can go to the other scheme, which mm-hmm. has these awesome benefits, and it's cheaper. So then you have this whole sort of selective lapsing effect. And this it's called the actuarial death spiral,
mm-hmm.
where basically your risk pool just deteriorates to the point and your contributions just keep increasing until your scheme is no longer sustainable. And then you have to amalgamate or liquidate the scheme.
So now, isn't this a problem with the design? Because I mean, I see the, I understand the philosophy behind the medical scheme. I mean, it's almost socialist in a way, in the sense that everyone's equal, you know, everyone's allowed to join, pay as much as you can, mm-hmm. you know, and take as much as you need.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's a beautiful philosophy. And I think it's, you know, it's very important when you want to provide healthcare on a macro level, you know, to the population. But as you've just been discussing, there are some fundamental flaws. I mean, it's even got a cool name, the actuarial death spiral. I mean, is there not a better way to provide healthcare? Like, I mean, don't we need to come together and design something completely new from the ground up when it comes to healthcare and how to finance it?
Yeah, I think that's something that the world is struggling with at the moment. I mean, you've got Obamacare, so obviously I don't know the exact details, but it's so politically opposed. And then you've got the NHI in the UK that is just is struggling financially. And it's and I think it all comes down to you won't be able to develop or build a system that works entirely if you don't change the opinion of people, because people sort of have this sort of view that they are entitled to certain benefits,
mm-hmm.
whereas it's only those who are truly in need who should be entitled to those benefits. So you've got over-servicing from the healthcare professionals. You've got over-utilization by people when they don't actually need mm-hmm. to go for these things. So I think everywhere we need to start re-looking, and I think the medical scheme industry is doing this now because it's the contribution increases which are happening at the moment are not sustainable for them. In the short term, sure, in the medium to long term. We need to come up with more innovative ways in order to cover, to save costs where it matters without jeopardizing the quality of care.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, there's various, one of the what's been happening now in the past decade or even two is that managed care organizations are being formed, which is also what my company does, as well as actuarial and administration. And they also are very popular in the United States. So managed care organizations will try and like manage your costs in an effective way or provide. So for example, they'll contract with doctors in order so the doctors are on the network and they charge these rates as opposed to doctors just charging whatever they want to set their rates as. Or they will look at disease management where if someone has a chronic disease, they're going to make sure that this person gets their tests done, that whole thing. So it's moving less into how do we give access to everyone how do we correctly manage these costs so that they don't spiral out of control? And it's a very complicated environment. And so another thing that's come up is now NHI, which mm-hmm. is due to be implemented in the next couple of years, which will basically in the final stages lead to the medical scheme industry not being what it is now. It will just offer supplementary services. So that's also a completely different ballgame now.
You look at, I mean, let's say if you were the president of a nation and you've got to manage your resources and you've got limited resources and you get presented with a choice one day. There's this 70-year-old man who's lived a good life, but he now has cancer and he needs R1 million treatment and his life expectancy is going to be another 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but it's going to cost R1 million. All you have these 10 children who desperately need R1 million across the 10 of them for an education and to get a head start in life. And I know that the one is medical and the other one's, you know, educational, but at the end of the day, you know, the state needs to look at how to allocate its resources.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a tricky thing to say because, you know, I mean, on one ethical side, you'd think rather use that money for the 10 children because they have much more, you know, years and there's a higher likelihood and it makes more sense. But to go to a 70-year-old person and say, you know, sorry, mate, game over, mm-hmm. you know, we're not going to give that money to you, even though you have been contributing to the system and you've been paying your taxes and you're part of this medical scheme, we're rather going to use that money to fund, you know, some children. You know, it is quite a, yeah, it's an interesting thing because there's, you know, no longer has it just become about, you know, actuarial science and the maths and all that type of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, have these ethical dilemmas coming in. I mean, another thing in the medical space is you have these pharmaceutical companies where they can pursue two business plans. Business plan A is let's put our research into developing a cure, you know, a pill you take once and we heal you from your disease. Mm-hmm. Let's say AIDS. Here's a pill, removes AIDS. Or option B is let's make a treatment for AIDS. So what we do is, instead of you just taking one of these pills and you're finished with the disease, you take this and it reduces the side effects of AIDS until you take the next pill the next week.
Mm-hmm.
And now, instead of me selling one pill to one person, I'm selling a pill every single week to this person, and I have a customer for life.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, from a purely capitalistic point of view, it's way more profitable to spend your money designing a treatment
mm-hmm.
rather than a cure. So I guess this comes down to the whole thing with medical schemes, and I think why they don't want it to be for profit is because, yeah, there's this whole cherry picking, and there is, you know, all these unethical, because let's admit, if you could create the cure or you could create the treatment, and mm-hmm. you'd rather go the treatment route because you want to make more money from it.
Sure.
I think that is unethical.
Yes. Yeah.
So I can see that the medical schemes have tried to get around this by saying it's not for profit.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that you get all these companies that are now administrative
yes.
or consultants, and, you know, they can take mm-hmm. profit otherwise, aren't, or isn't that regulation getting bypassed? Isn't that?
So there are some safeguards in place. So if you go and have a look at the Council of Medical Schemes annual report, they mm-hmm. do go and list every single scheme in South Africa, and they go and list how much, they break down their financials, basically. And one of the big things is the managed care, the administration, all the other expenses. There's been a lot of pressure on the schemes lately that is not increasing.
Mm-hmm.
So it has been increasing in line with inflation, but it hasn't been increasing excessively. And one of the good benchmarks to have is that your non-healthcare expenditure, that is your administration fee, your actuarial services, your trustee salaries, all of that, that must not exceed 10% of your gross contributions,
mm-hmm.
which is your savings and your risk contributions together. So if that's more than 10%, then the council, which is sort of regulates the industry, the medical scheme industry, they'll sort of be like, no, what's happening here? You know, sort yourself out or whatever. Yeah.
Because, I mean, it's
all publicly available knowledge or information that you can leverage off to be like, well, is this scheme a scheme I want to be a part of because they charge 15% of the gross contribution. 15% of their gross contribution is non-healthcare expenditure.
The thing is, I mean, I remember there was this city, I think it was an American city, which introduced a law saying there's a rent ceiling. You mm-hmm. cannot charge more for rent, you know, to try mm-hmm. and limit the power of the landlord.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the evil landlord has all this land and people have to rent from him, and because, you know, there's a big demand but a limited supply, the prices are just going up and up and up.
Mm-hmm.
So the city decided, we're going to have a rental ceiling. You cannot charge more than, say, $1,000 a month, just say that's the number.
Mm-hmm.
But the landlords want money, you know.
Uh-huh.
Just like I think most people in life, we are driven by the financial side of things. And so what they did is they said to people, yo, you can rent the room for $1,000, okay? But if you want the key to, you know, lock it, that's going to cost $5,000 a month. And what they're saying is, no, you can borrow, you know, you can rent it. We're meeting that minimum criteria.
Mm-hmm.
We've just added on a value service,
yes.
you know, at a ridiculous rate that has kind of undermined the whole mm-hmm. the whole thing. And the thing is, people were still prepared to pay $5,000 mm. for the lock because, like I said, the supply was so high
mm.
and the demand was so high and the supply was
yeah.
so low. So, I'm very skeptical when it comes to, you know, regulations or these mm. things to try and limit it. I mean, with my medical aid scheme, I don't think I've once checked, you know, how much contribution goes to whoever.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm very much of, okay, this amount I pay, this is what I get.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very much of the opinion that, you know, you've got medical insurance is probably, especially in my stage of life, it's the most important product that I need.
Mm-hmm. Are you talking health insurance? Are you talking medical scheme?
Well, I'm just saying my medical risk.
Yes. Okay, cool.
So I don't have any dependents, so I don't have any life insurance. If I had to die, I don't think, you know, people might cry, but that's, you know, that's about it. I mean, household insurance, it's too expensive. I'll take the risk. You know, someone breaks in and steals all my stuff, you know, that's a risk that I'll self-insure. Okay, I do have car insurance. Car insurance, you know, you kind of have to have that one. But like I said, as far as like, say, saving instruments or, you know, putting money away for this and that, to me, those are, you know, you don't really need them. As someone my age, you know, who doesn't have dependents. But medical is the one thing that I'm very much aware of. Because, I mean, worst case scenario is you get this disease and then you're this massive burden on your family. And of course, they're going to try to sell the family jewels to pay for you. And then you're going to feel bad and you're probably still going to die anyway. So I think it's such an important product. I'm just, I'm really surprised that it's not for profit in the sense that, you know, you do have these, I don't know, look, it's maybe something I need to brush up a little bit more on. What in your opinion is the future of this? Because I mean, another thing, on the Facebook page, we had someone come and try sell a hospital plan. On the Actuarial page, they came in, they're like, oh, 30 rand a month for a hospital plan. I mean, this thing was terrible in the sense that,
there was actually a circular that was released recently to, for the draft, it's not called the Demarcation Act, it's called the Long-Term Insurance Act or change, anyway, basically what it's saying is that, there's a difference between a health insurance product and a medical scheme. So the definition of the business of a medical scheme, it's like three or four criteria and sort of like providing, making provision for medical services and sort of pooling of funds and all of that. And you get a health insurer that comes in and they do risk rating. So that's the hospital cash plan now I'm talking about. And it's the hospital cash plan. It's the,
I think those are terrible.
They are terrible.
And that's what this person was trying to sell this thing to me. Because what it does is you get sick, you go to hospital, and they're like, here's 200 rand. But I could be going in for like a little cough, and there's like 50 rand. Or I could be going in because I've got an axe through my head, and I need surgery, and it's 10,000 rand.
So the thing with the health insurance products is they're not allowed to indemnify the policyholder. They cannot say, we will cover your medical costs, because that is the business of a medical scheme. So it is now a whole thing that it hasn't come into, it hasn't been, it's just draft regulations at the moment, but they're saying a whole bunch of criteria being like, well, a health insurance person, they cannot pay the providers directly. They cannot pay the hospital. They have to pay you in your pocket.
And they cannot indemnify. They use that as a marketing ploy. We give you 500 rand, as you can use on school fees, on your own lunch, or on anything.
But now what happens is that you have this huge financially unsophisticated market in South Africa. These people do not understand the difference between a medical scheme and health insurance. So they get a hospital cash plan and they think that they are now covered.
That's what it's about.
To go and get treatment in the hospital. Meanwhile, the daily amounts that they're offering are nowhere near sufficient to stay in a private hospital. And if you're going to a government hospital, if your salary is low enough, you're not going to be paying. But and even if it is high enough, it's still not cheap to go and you know, go to hospital at all. Obviously, it's not cheap.
Isn't this legal theft then?
Health insurance. Well, that's what the government and the, you know, Department of Health is concerned about, because you're misleading the public. You're actually taking away the financial or the stability of the medical aid industry. Because what you're also doing is you have all these healthy lives here who cannot really afford the medical aid contribution because it's super cheap. They even, some insurance, health insurance are now offering you GP visits. They're offering you dental. They're offering you, they'll be like, well, here's a set amount. You know, you can go to the GP as unlimited times. And, because of PMBs, medical schemes have to offer them. There is a minimum cost to providing cover through a medical scheme. Whereas a health insurer, they don't need PMBs. They can exclude old sick people. They can exclude people based on whatever sort of thing. Anyway, and they can also risk rate. so they can charge you higher amounts. So they have all this covered. So a very healthy young person will find a, especially those with families as well, they'll find a package where you get GP visits, unlimited GP visits, like invaluable. So they'll take that up. They'll leave the medical scheme. They'll be paying a tenth of the price at the health insurer. And then you have all these people funneling in here and leaving the medical scheme industry, the risk pool to deteriorate. And then you have all these people here that are under the impression that they are covered and when actually they're not. So they aren't covered for emergencies. They aren't covered for any of the chronic diseases, for cancer or anything like that. So you actually have a large portion of the population going uncovered, effectively, when they think they are being covered.
Because, I mean, that's what's making up such a big chunk of your contribution is, like I said, cancer is very expensive.
So actually, it's not taking up that much of a chunk of your contribution because the prevalence is so low. Well, it depends on the scheme, actually. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about a discovery, I don't think it's going to take up. So if we're looking at the broad costs of the claims costs of the scheme, you're going to get about 30% is going to be hospital. So that's people being admitted, and that's accommodation in the hospital, specialists, everything that happens in the hospital. And then you get another big chunk, which is medicines, which is acute medicines and chronic medicines, and then you get the rest. So cancer, the prevalence rate and the incidence rate is quite low, actually. Because, the incidence rate's low in the general population in any case. So it's a very severe thing. It's low frequency. So actually, if it's covered across a huge number of people, it's actually a very, because what we like to express it as is cost per life per month.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, we'll take the total claims divided by the total months that the people are in the scheme divided by the total people. So then that comes down to a cost per life per month. And it's actually quite small compared to your, say, the total GP visits.
So then how are hospital plans being able to be so much cheaper than medical schemes? What's making medical schemes so expensive for your everyday buyer?
Okay, so there's a number of factors for this as well. So there's the PMBs, which are the base of every medical scheme.
That's the prescribed minimal benefits.
Yes, the prescribed minimum benefits.
Cool.
Every scheme in South Africa has to offer these benefits. And so another thing is that providers who offer these PMB, the treatment and diagnosis of PMBs, they have to, the schemes have to pay them at whatever cost that they are charging them. And this was because of some court case a couple of years ago. So you have a scheme being charged 400-500% of the tariff rate, and these PMBs escalating at a rate far greater than CPI. Then the hospital plans don't have to offer these. So that's just one portion. Okay, on top of that, now you have overutilization by members. And I actually had a conversation with someone who did an applied maths degree the other day. Mm-hmm. And I was trying to explain this to them, and I was like, she was like, no, but I get those benefits. They're my benefits. I should be able to use them. So it's like, for example, 3 GP visits or a physiotherapy session that you get covered by risk, not from savings. She said, no, but they're mine. I should be able to use them. But there's nothing necessarily wrong with her. She just has this sense of entitlement that, but I'm paying for this.
That I might as well get them.
I must get the full
Even if I'm not sick, let me go to the doctor.
Yes. Or even if I'm not sick, let me go to the physio because my shoulder's a little bit sore or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So now you have this weird sort of thing where the members are overclaiming because they feel entitled to benefits. So then you're driving up costs because people, and especially for elective things. So the more complex plans, not even the more complex plans, it's a PMB that they have to offer pregnancy-related benefits. So what happens, and it happened to a scheme now, which is in big trouble, one of the bigger schemes, the biggest in South Africa, mm-hmm. biggest closed scheme. They didn't have any underwriting when people join the scheme.
Yeah, so they're not allowed to, hey?
They can.
But they can.
Anyone can. You can. So it's like the only underwriting you can do is waiting periods. So you say, okay, you have this disease. You're not allowed to claim for anything to do with this disease for 12 months. Or you can say a general waiting period of 3 months.
Like pregnancy, they normally have like a 9 month.
So pregnancy has a waiting period usually in other schemes. This particular scheme didn't have waiting periods. So what would happen is people would join the scheme while they're pregnant. They would cost the scheme a heck of a lot of money and then they'd leave. So what you're having is people are coming in, they're contributing for say 6 months. They're claiming about 2 years worth of contributions and then they're leaving. So that's driving up those costs. So that's also, so it's elective procedures which drive those up. Then you've got from providers. So you have all these restrictions that are placed on treatment by the schemes. The schemes will, and that's trying to control costs. So it'll be like there's networks, go to our like a doctor in the network and you won't have a copay. And then they have this agreement with the doctor. So all these things are in place, but then that leaves a little bit of sort of information asymmetry, and it's a bit of a perverse incentive from the doctor's side to try and make more money somehow.
Mm-hmm.
So the doctors can end up pushing like supplier-induced demand. And it's also, if you're a patient and someone, and a doctor who has a medical degree says to you, you need this
treatment.
You're not necessarily going to say
no,
especially if it's, you're not paying for it. So it's a whole third party payer thing as well. So if you're not paying for it, a doctor tells you you need this, you're probably going to go and get it done.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all these, this is just, and there's a lot of other factors such as the exchange rate. So it comes down to if we're importing medicine, and our exchange and the rand deteriorates.
Don't we have derivatives and stuff to hedge those all?
No.
Don't the medical administrators?
The medical schemes. The medical schemes actually have a strict investment. They're regulated for their investments. They cannot invest more than 4% in derivatives, I think.
Well, that's dumb.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of dumb. Well, it depends. It's a short-term business. You've got a lot of short-term claims. Most of the money that medical schemes hold are in cash.
Okay.
Yeah.
But then, like you said, like it comes down to this currency risk.
Yeah, so it is a risk, but it's not the main thing, I would say, that's driving the contribution increases. And then, of course, you've got the healthier lives leaving, and you've got all the sicker lives staying. And that just drives, and then you don't have the cross-subsidization from the healthy to the sick, and then you have this...
See, this
actuarial death spiral.
This put me off health, because not only do I get very squeamish when I hear blood and, you know, cardio bypass surgery and all that stuff, you know, makes me dizzy. But looking at all of this, it kind of feels like it's a bit of a sinking ship, you know. And it's something that I also got the same impression when it came to pensions. You know, mm-hmm. people are living longer and they're retiring earlier and all these type of things. So it's... I guess it's good news for us because it means we're going to have a job, you know, and
exactly.
And, you know, so these people, society will still need us, but it's almost as if we've created these problems, or our, you know, the last generation of actuaries created these problems, because it sounds all good in theory, but then when you look at people joining in, claiming, jumping out, or, you know, these hospital insurance things popping up here and all these other things coming up, it does very much sound like a sinking ship. So I think we're doing quite well for time.
How are we doing? Oh my gosh, we've been talking for 44 minutes.
Oh my word, are you serious?
Okay, so let's maybe just end off with one very quick question, and that is, where do you see the future of South Africa from a medical point of view in, say, 10 years' time? Is it going to be good? Have we... In the future, do we solve all the problems and everybody's happy, or do we stuff up and South Africa goes down in flames and we all get sick and we get wiped out by like the Black Plague or something like that? What is your forecast on South Africa's medical state in 10 years' time?
So that is a very difficult question to answer, because...
And you have 5 seconds to answer it. No, I'm joking.
No, so there's just like, there's the NHI, there's the deterioration of the medical scheme industry, there is our shortage of doctors, especially in the public sector. There is the severe financial inequality. We're the most unequal society in the world. So how do you take the private sector and apply it to the entire country, which is basically what we're dealing with now, because the public sector is in shambles. We cannot rely on the public sector to provide healthcare for the entire country. It is just not feasible.
So in 10 years' time, do future actuaries like us figure out all these problems and make it all better, or does the ship continue to sink until it's no longer sailable?
Well, I guess that depends on the political party that's ruling.
But in your opinion, is it good or is it bad?
I'm going to stay optimistic and say it's good.
Okay, fantastic. And I think this may be ended off there. Because we're just 46 minutes now. Gosh, this has been...
Are we going to say a conclusion?
I don't know if people are still probably going to be listening to
it. Well, you're going to have to edit it.
So you could
edit this into two parts and just cut out all the rest.
So I'm going to say goodbye. Do you want to say goodbye?
Do you want to say goodbye or do you want to say thank you? Or I don't know, what do people say?
Let's just go with the classic. Hey guys, thanks for watching. Hit like, hit subscribe. See you next time.
Bye.
Cheers.